All right, welcome everybody to the RSP Film Room. This is episode number 82 for Ozzy Newsome. I think Ozzy Newsome was 82, but we aren't going to be watching tight ends. We're going to be watching guys who sometimes cover tight ends. Probably the most requested player that has been in my suggestion box pretty much all year long for 2016's draft, and that is linebacker Darron Lee of Ohio State. So I thought to get the most requested player, then I also thought it would be good to have the most requested guest that I often have on the show that has, I have such a great response rate from people when we have him on, and that's none other than Jene Bramel of Football Guys. Welcome, Jene.
Thanks, Matt. I appreciate it. I think we could have had, I don't know, there's got to be a defensive player with number 82, doesn't there, somewhere, somehow?
I would.
Newsome, if you're gonna choose an offensive player that can get into the hearts of defensive guys, Ozzy would fit for sure.
Yeah, it would. And we're old school today, you know. I mean,
that's true.
At least the way I'm looking right now with all this gray in my beard, you know.
Wisdom.
Yes, hard earned. Let's see. So we are going – tell me a little bit about what you've seen of Darron Lee that makes him an interesting player in this draft and kind of what you're hearing about him, you know, kind of on the street for those who may not have requested Darron Lee but are interested in learning more about him.
So I think there's two just quick overall generic takes that come to mind. And one is that we are definitely entering into a time where the league is looking for athletes. And as we've talked about many times on the Audible and other places, athlete does not necessarily mean football player. Now, in today's league, you have to be athletic enough to hang because the league is full of athletes. But at some point, athleticism does not mean that you are going to be a viable football player. And I'm not saying that Darron Lee falls into either one of those categories. And then I think the other thing that strikes me is that because of the injury concerns with Miles Jack and Jalen Smith, as we get closer and closer to the draft, there's more and more concerns. Jalen Smith is not going to get drafted probably on the first or even the second day, I don't believe. I don't think Miles Jack issue is nearly as big as what – it's clearly not nearly as big as – what Jalen Smith is going through. But I think Darron Lee is being elevated up possibly a little bit more, not only because of his athleticism, but because he's the healthiest, hopeful elite linebacker on the board. I know Leonard Floyd's getting a little bit of run. We talked about him offline earlier today and what he may fit into certain ways and what he may not fit into certain ways. But I think Darron Lee kind of has that consensus number one off-ball linebacker behind Jack and Smith. And some people are trying to elevate him into that triumvirate, so to speak. And maybe Darron Lee is a half step ahead of some of the other off-ball linebackers that are going to be on the board this year. But I don't think on film he's necessarily close to what Smith can do, what Jack can do as far as all-around linebackers, athletes that can play an all-around linebacker role. So I think we're going to get into some of the things that make him athlete, make him potentially football player, show the upside that he may have as he comes into the league. But I think one of the themes tonight is, as you know, we kind of went through on Twitter with a few folks earlier this week and through the weekend, is that don't equate athlete with football player just yet. The skills have to be there. And I know that's something, especially with the wide receiver position and the running backs, but something you talk about a lot on the offensive side with the RSP is that there has to be a level of technical skill that goes along with the athleticism, or these players aren't going to succeed.
Yeah, that's great. So let's talk a little bit about what an off-the-ball linebacker is and what you look for in that role from a defensive player.
Yeah, I think maybe even as recently as 2 or 3 years ago, we were still – I think draft Twitter is really what changed the way we classify front seven personnel. And Josh Norris and others sort of started it, and I think it made a whole lot of sense in terms of – I don't really talk about players as, well, you've got a 4-3 middle linebacker versus a 3-4 inside linebacker versus a 4-3 outside linebacker versus a 3-4 outside linebacker. I think we're seeing so much versatility nowadays, and the way the 3-4 scheme itself has changed into, it's more of a one-gap scheme. It's as much of a one-gap scheme, I should say, as a 4-3 defense. And so it just makes sense with teams morphing from base packages to sub packages to multiple defensive schemes. You can't 4-3 defensive ends and 3-4 outside linebackers are an awful lot alike at this point. And the term tweener, I think, has changed. to where in the past you would think of a tweener as, well, maybe not strong enough to be a 4-3 defensive end, but maybe not athletic enough to be a 3-4 outside linebacker, so they're a tweener. Now I think that term has morphed into, well, that type of player, you know, the guys we talked about last year, from Vic Beasley to Bud Dupree to Dante Fowler to Shane Ray, guys that can probably play both of those roles arguably equally well because of scheme and because of talent and athleticism. And I think we're seeing that now further back away from the ball, where we're just talking about guys that are not edge rushers but play the linebacker position as off-ball linebackers, be that a 3-4 weak inside linebacker, 3-4 strong inside linebacker, 4-3 middle, 4-3 will. And that encompasses a lot of different players. It just means that it's a player that's going to be called a linebacker whose primary job, not that they can't bring some of that, and Darron Lee, as we'll see, can bring some, a little bit of a straight line pass rush, just aren't technically seen as edge rusher. So we're separating defensive linemen into interior linemen, true down three-point stance linemen, and then edge rushers, and then off-ball linebackers. At least I think that's the correct way to think about these players now, because it speaks to how they're going to be used in the NFL rather than trying to pigeonhole them into some convention that's been used since the 1970s.
That's great. So do you think by any chance that when you talk about now it's evolved from, oh, these guys aren't hybrids, these are every down type of guys, and is it because of the way that offenses have changed that now that these players are more fit to be able to do that, whereas maybe back in the 1990s when Emmitt Smith and Terrell Davis were pounding the ball relentlessly into defenses, or Marion Butts was the running back in the day, that these guys might not have been able to hang back then as well?
Well, I think so. A few things. I think Emmitt Smith is an interesting name to bring up there because it was Jimmy Johnson that really brought athletes as defenders into the league. He was at Oklahoma State and knew that he couldn't recruit against Miami, against, you know, the biggest names and the biggest colleges. So he said, well, I'm just going to get the athletes and I'm going to let them go get the ball. So he had 240-pound defensive ends. He had 210-pound linebackers, and he just said, go get the ball. And that he carried that through to the University of Miami. He carried that through to Dallas. And lots of the 4-3 schemes of the late 90s, and even into the 2000s were built on that idea, go get an athlete and let him play. And that worked if you're more athletic than anyone else. And that's the way college defenses and college offenses have seemed to work as well. They go get athletes knowing that on Saturdays, you can out-athlete the other team in lots of regards. That doesn't happen on Sundays unless you are truly, truly, truly elite. If you talk about the athletic guys, recently Levante David always comes to mind as a guy that just, you know, you don't think of him as a big player, but if you watch him play, he plays much bigger than his size. Yes, he's athlete, but there's power, there's athleticism, all that sort of stuff comes together. So double back to where we are today, I think the new hybrids today are arguably linebacker safety types. You're seeing Cam Chancellor, you're seeing Mark Barron, you're seeing Telvin Smith. Thomas Davis is sort of the grandfather of this, so to speak, where teams, the poster boy for this, for those of you guys that follow fantasy football, is Adam Archuleta. Adam Archuleta was, the in-the-box safety type that couldn't cover and that couldn't take angles very well. And sooner or later, he was just phased out because he was an athlete who wasn't athletic enough or football player enough to do what needed to be done. Thomas Davis sort of flipped the script, and now we're seeing that over and over and over again. And I did mention Deion Buchanan, but him and Telvin Smith are sort of opposite sides of that. In Telvin Smith, you've got a 219-pound linebacker who can play with a six-man front in all phases, and then the same thing with Deion Buchanan, but they're coming at it from different traditions in the college game. One was a defensive back and one was a linebacker, and I think that's where we're going there. You can't say that with Miles Jack's 245 pounds. So you may say, oh, he can play safety, he may be able to play inside linebacker. You're talking about a 245-pound player, so he's really not a hybrid in that regard, and nobody's going to put him at the third level of the defense and expect him to play that sort of role. He's going to be a linebacker, and the same thing goes with Darron Lee. You're getting that sort of player. And I think everybody wants to, now that we've been a couple of years into this sort of new tradition, automatically equate these very fast off-ball linebackers as these hybrid types. Well, that's really not what's going on here. It's just an athletic player that plays on the outside that you're hoping is going to be able to fill in every down role.
So if you've never seen the RSP film room and you've never seen Jene Bramel talk about anything other than injuries, then now you understand why I love having Jene Bramel on this show, because this is how I met Jene. This is what I knew about Jene first, was that he knew a ton about defense and football, and it wasn't that, oh yeah, by the way, he's also a doctor and understands the ins and outs of the human anatomy, other than, as my wife would joke, the Achilles tendon. So with that in mind, yeah, exactly, drink. So with that in mind, we're going to watch Darron Lee, and for those of you who are new to the show, I do have to go through a little bit of a legal disclaimer here to let everybody know that the videos here posted on the RSP film room are not hosted on this server, and the original video content is not considered to be the property of the RSP film room. The videos are considered to be used under the fair use doctrine of the United States copyright law, Title 17 U.S. Code sections 107 through 118, and the videos are used on this site for the editorial and educational purposes only, and that the RSP film room and its staff don't claim ownership of any original video content, and the RSP film room and its staff do not use these video clips in advertisements, marketing, or for direct financial gain, and all video content in each clip is considered to be owned by the individual broadcast companies. So Big Ten, if you want to monetize this on YouTube, you're going to go right ahead and do that. I hope I get lots of clicks for you and that somebody in your ad department can go on a nice vacation or a conference. with that in mind, we're watching cut-ups here that are supplied by the illustrious Draft Breakdown, who save my bacon pretty much every year with just the fantastic job they do for all of us writers, but especially for poor schleps like me who sit here and study film all the time. So thank you very much, fellas. Keep up the great work, and we're going to go ahead and get this set up so that Jene and I can watch this at the same time. How does that look to you?
Pretty good.
All right, good. Now I'm going to start this off in half speed like we normally do, because it doesn't jump as round as much. And if we feel like that we need to change the speed, you just let me know, Jene.
Okay.
So we're going to get Darron Lee. It looks like he's over at number 43 on the right side of the offense here over the tight end. Got ourselves a little bit of an eye formation going on here with a fullback-like guy. You know, patient covering his side, it looks like, you know, accounting for his gap. Oops. What happened here? All right, let's try this one more time. Something jumped, and I think it was me. All right, so a nice little second effort by 24 here. He just gets taken out of the play.
Yeah, he's hooked a little bit there. And I think, you know, as I so often do, we end up nitpicking these guys just to find some stuff to talk about. But, you know, one of the things that's evident to me about Lee as I watch him is that his eyes always seem to be in the right place. But I wonder if the recurring thing for me is, I wonder if he knows he's the most athletic person there in that front seven, and he's willing to have his athleticism make up for some technical deficiencies. Not that there's a whole lot necessarily in this play, but you kind of see, you know, he's a little hair slower to react than some of these others, and he's kind of taking some extra steps and mirroring along, gets his hands in a decent spot and sees what's going on in that muck pile there. But didn't really, not that he's not physical or powerful, because we'll see some of that later, but, you know, he's just sort of moving. You know, I mean, he's not really coming downhill. He's not looking to deliver a blow. And really, this offensive lineman just takes a wing and just shoves him out of the play there.
Yeah.
Where you'd like to see him really just smash in there and make a play.
Yeah, and he looks like he was about to do that, but I mean, I call this a Steve Slayton run. This was the type of runs that Steve Slayton would make with the Texans as a rookie all the time, where it just seemed like he was stuck for nothing, and then he'd spin out, and there'd be defenders with good angles where it just got taken away. So I agree with you, Jene. It's, you know, we don't want to nitpick him too much on that particular play, but if it's something you're seeing consistently, we're going to see more of it pretty soon.
I like angry linebackers. I don't know if that's the term that we really want to use here or not, but and I recognize that there's lots of, you know, You know, I recognize that there's lots of different ways that that defenses are going to play, and there's some read and react schemes, and these guys aren't necessarily coached to come flying downhill. Stacked linebackers are not here, but you know, I am always going to favor players that come downhill and meet players at the line of scrimmage. So I always think twice when I see a little bit of tap dancing, even if that's what they're taught to do.
Yeah, and I agree with you, and I think that, you know, I always find it interesting who I know who was raised on AFC Central football, because it's back in the day when the Steelers, the Bengals, the Browns, and the Oilers played that hard-nosed football, I think everyone who was raised on that always appreciates when whether it's the offensive player or the defensive player, they take the physical game to the opponent. And this is a good example of where, you know, he tries to shed. He's a little lighter than, you know, 37 here.
And he's getting held.
Yeah.
So one of the reasons we were originally planning on watching Notre Dame, but there really wasn't a whole lot. Notre Dame had a lot of zone read type situations, and Darron Lee, as we'll see in some of these games and situations we're going to watch, was out over the slot a lot. So there wasn't a lot of this to watch. Wasn't a lot of ISO situations where Lee's going to get matched up on anybody, especially as an off the ball type player. And this goes back to functional strength and footwork and power. And did Lee do his job here? Arguably, yes. He turned the play back inside. But when you see a linebacker take on a block, you want to see them not necessarily be the first person to deliver the blow, but you really, really like to see 2 feet on the ground when they stack, because this is just not going to work on Sundays. He is going to be pancaked if he's got especially that inside leg up off the ground. You know, you like to see the helmet below the helmet there. You like to see the pads below the pads, but that is just not going to work.
Yeah.
And it works here because he gets, you know, he's quick enough to beat that fullback. He's quick enough to draw the hold, but he's going to end up on his bottom if this happens a lot on Sundays.
Those are great points. And it's very notable to see on that replay why that didn't work out.
And he'll do this a lot. He is really, really quick, and he'll rely on his athleticism to shed. His hand placement is pretty good, and he moves really quickly. There's a play in a little while where the offensive lineman just completely loses sight of him, and he scoots around him like I might scoot around a 4-year-old. But you know, as he gets into the next level, that's going to be a harder thing to do.
So is the analogy that I'm going to get to make in the future about defenders is that you can scoot quicker than Jene Bramel around a 4-year-old at a pediatrician examination?
I don't know that that's saying much, but it's the first thing that came to mind for obvious reasons.
I like his eyes are always in the, you know, I mean, he knows how to keep his eyes where he needs to be, like you said. You can see that even on this play, even though, you know, he takes three options to get to the ball here,
which is an area of his game that hurts him at times too. I can't remember if we'll see it in this game or not, but there are a lot of instances where he falls prey to play action and he doesn't get as good a depth as he needs to on his pass drops, or misdirection hurts him because he's really keying the ball with his eyes and he could be moved a little bit easier.
Yeah. And it looked like, too, in this play, I mean, he knows his size is a detriment, you know, to facing a left tackle, and didn't really want to even get the left tackle's hands on him in any way, shape, or form on this play. And that's something that kind of concerns. I wonder about that because, I mean, at the same time, you want to see a guy who's playing, you know, he's an outside linebacker in a sense, or an off-the-ball guy. I'd like to see him to have some sort of a pass rush or develop some sort of a move.
Yeah, that's interesting. I mean, somebody smarter than me would have to look at that and say for certain. I don't know if that was a designed stunt with Bosa really driving hard upfield with the intent of taking both of those guys all the way up there. But the way Lee approached that, it almost looked he was disappointed. Like, I didn't think I was going to have to deal with the tackle here. I thought I was making a beeline. But you can see the way this protection was slid, that the idea was for that offensive line to come in this direction to handle Bosa, because that the running back has no interest in looking to his left there at all.
Yeah.
So there's a couple of things that's difficult to answer there, but I doubt this was a design stunt, because I don't really see. I think that's more he recognizes the tackle on a pass set and seeing what's going on and then trying to break back inside rather than, because I think he'd have made that move a little bit sooner. And then you see Bosa kind of bending that up inside. So I think that was a situation, as you said, where, the tackle's coming out to get me. I got to find another way here because this isn't going to work.
Yeah. It's well protected.
Either that or he's – I don't know why you have Darron Lee running a stunt there with Bosa anyway, but I'm not sure that was – if that's what it was, it really wasn't a well-run stunt.
No. So now we get to see him dropped a little bit more in the flat, covering the flat on this play where we got play action. And he's in the screen.
Yeah, you know, they do this a lot. As I watch his games a little bit more carefully, I think – on these plays where the quarterback rolls out, they are coached to sprint to the sideline here. And I think he's coached to make sure he gets pretty far outside, either that, or this is just something that he does where he doesn't realize he's as close to the sideline as he should. But this is not the only time you'll see this particular situation out of Lee where he looks like he overruns the area in the flat where he's supposed to be. But it happens so often that it almost seems like he's coached to sprint to a spot or to get, a little bit wider when the quarterback comes down and does this.
That's interesting. That's very interesting because, I mean, I'm looking at this and I'm thinking,
what's he doing?
What's he doing? He's way outside here. But that would be interesting to ask in this case.
As you can see, the middle linebacker kind of doing the same thing. They are both. I mean, it's a full-out sprint, too. It's not as if he's trying to get depth to a particular spot, and he clearly overruns the numbers here. So, it's another one of those things where it's hard to know exactly what's coached in the playbook, or at least I'm not well-versed enough to know specifically what to do there. But
yeah, I mean, so far looking at this, I mean, it's just one of those situations that, you have to watch more tape. You have to see, you'd have to be able to ask, if you had a chance as a scout, you'd have to be able to ask the coaching staff about this and see where it goes. Now we're going to get a chance to see him off the edge here.
And they definitely moved him around. They asked him to do a lot of stuff. When he's facing a pretty spread set, there's many times where he's out over the numbers covering slot, whether it be zone. And there are some situations where he'll play man out of that situation, but he's up given a jam. There are times on these longer third down plays where they'll put him in a pass rush situation. We've already seen two of them here against Michigan State. And it's nothing, I mean, there's nothing special about this. He's just trying to be quicker than the opponent he's against. There's really no technical skill in what he did there. Right. He's just trying to beat a guy off a ball. You see him almost stagger from side to side on that edge rush. That's not something he's going to be asked to do.
No. And, he's facing a pretty good tackle in Conklin, who's going to be a first-round pick.
I mean, he's widening out. He's trying to bend around and do whatever instead of getting up underneath that. He's just – his job there is to move the pocket. And if he gets there, he gets there.
Now, was Lee a safety when he came to school? That's something I wondered about.
Yeah, I don't remember. A lot of these guys are. He's got reasonable size. I think he measured around 240. I'm remembering right. So he's not a small dude, but a lot of these guys put on 15, 20 pounds and start out as, defensive back type athletes. And, what you will see, the athleticism is easily evident in his range. Even with some pitter pattery steps, he has no difficulty getting sideline to sideline with no trouble at all.
Yeah, and he does a good job maintaining the outside gap on that play, even though it's nothing consequential in terms of how that's going to work out, how he influenced that play. But he played disciplined there. He maintains his discipline on this play.
Yeah, he wants to run around the block a little bit instead of getting up underneath there some. But
yeah, true.
He does – there are some physical hits that he'll do. He will take on some blocks, but again, I think this is there. In some ways, he's akin to the running back going to the corner store that you see. He wants to. I think his first thought is often to evade rather than stack and shed.
Darron Lee showed a little bit of that. I'm not Darron Lee. Noah Spence showed a little bit of that in our earlier film room when he was playing the run. He was like trying to avoid. Rather than to attack.
So this will be a good example of that. If you see where he starts and where he finishes, he's You know, there's plenty of acceleration between the numbers for him. It's not a problem for him to work through trash. And despite all this that we're talking about here, you really don't see him on the ground much. You know, he's not been taken to the ground by blockers. It's not that sort of struggle. He stays on his feet, which is helpful.
Absolutely. So here we go.
Recognition skills, and he's not being run away from there. And I think had that play continued, he might have been able to impact that play on the backside, starting from a situation where he had contain on the zone read and coming all the way across the formation.
All right, another sprint outside. All right. In this case, we just had a simple out play, so that's not going to be anything consequential there.
I think you're seeing here what he's going to be. Is he a guy that could potentially work as a 3-4 weak inside linebacker? Yeah, but he looks like a flow and chase guy.
Yeah. So when you look at something like that, you know, before I've really had a chance to look at him a good bit, I know that I was asked on the Norse Code podcast by Arif Hassan and Dusty O'Connell whether or not, you know, if the Vikings weren't picking a wide receiver first, or I couldn't pick a wide receiver in the first round, who would be some of my candidates to consider? And, you know, one of the thoughts I mentioned was, well, Darron Lee possibly as your weak side linebacker to replace Greenway down the line. But does he... You know, one of the things that I've heard too is that he tends to miss a lot of tackles. And then I thought, well, Zimmer doesn't seem to be a guy that would probably want to truck with that. And he's probably more of a guy that also wants guys who can stack and shed a little bit more. Does he strike you as a Zimmer guy for a Minnesota type of defense that's similar to what the Bengals had?
I think, you know, can a guy be coached up to do some of those things? Possibly. I mean, he's big enough to be able to do it. I mean, you know, in this play in particular, well, the one before it actually, okay, it was a pretty good opportunity to see how he was going to take on a block. And it was, you know, another situation where he's just getting, you know, because of how his footwork is, he's just, you know, you don't have a good chance to see what sort of functional strength he may have. Because once the tackle gets up to him on the second level, I mean, that in itself doesn't look terrible, but, you know, as he tries to shed, he just doesn't, you know, he's not locking out his arms. He's not, you know, he's not showing any leverage there at all.
Yeah, I mean, when he attacks, he leans in rather than getting his hips under it and really
he's catching and trying to figure out a way to get off as quickly as possible. But if somebody's arms get on him, he's in trouble. If he's got quick enough hands to disengage and use his quickness and athleticism to shed, that works for him. But there's not a whole lot of power, at least in this part of his game. So can you teach him to recognize this block instead of looking to see where the ball is at this point, and then on both of these plays, kind of get in there and impact the tackle and move? So you see him, this is the same tackle, pretty similar situation, tackle coming up to the second level. The first time he catches the block, this time he didn't really want any part of it. He's trying to evade it in a different way.
Himself out of the play a little bit.
Yeah, I mean, he's using the outside leverage that he needs to, but it's really not impacting.
Now, obviously, you see the athletic ability. He closes quickly. You saw that on that last play. You know, here we see him coming down the line pretty nicely here.
Yeah, range is not going to be a problem for him.
Yeah.
There he is. He does have some, unlike Ryan Shazier, there's some understanding of angles here as well with him. Ryan Shazier, there were times where you just didn't know where he was going or why. And you don't really see that with Lee.
Now, how about this Perry guy? You were talking about we should keep an eye on number 37 Perry here.
Josh Perry is 6'4", about 255. He runs a 4.6 40. And he really tests off the charts. But when you watch him, he just doesn't play that physically. He has some problems with stacking and shedding. His coverage skills are probably not going to be good enough, but he's got the measurables that there are some times, I forget which game it was. There's a couple of games where you'll see him stack and shed really well, lock out his arms, play physically. So it's there. But there are other times like this where he just, you know, you're just not really sure what you're going to get. I mean, that's not terrible, but I think there's potential there. The first time I was exposed to him was at the Senior Bowl, and just watching him move through the linebacker drills, you thought, my gosh, that dude is big, but he's as fluid as some of the other guys we're seeing down here. And he pulled his groin the first day, and we never really got to see him in any additional drills and coverage drills or anything else. And I don't know how well he would have held up in those situations, but just on paper, I can see somebody thinking about him in the third round just because of all the measurables he's got.
And see, now, this is something I want to ask you about. So I'm watching this play, and here I am. I don't know if Perry knows that his teammate's right here at the hash like this, or senses that his teammate should be here at the hash like this. But if I am watching this play, I would think, okay, this is my gap to shoot right here. Like, get downhill. And instead, he's like, okay, I'm going to slide over and at least take on some of 64 coming at me. When it just seemed to me watching it, I'm thinking he could have avoided 64 completely and forced, you know, the running back either into number five, or it would be a head-on situation with Perry winning this.
Yeah, there's not a whole lot of actually. Raekwon McMillan of all three linebackers is generally the one that seems like he has the most attacking mentality. And there's some issues with McMillan just sort of watching him and passing with the other guys. He runs himself out of plays pretty frequently. But I'm left to wonder as I watch a lot of Ohio State tape whether their linebackers are really taught to mash downhill. I mean, you see McMillan right here, he's coming. The other two guys, they're, you know, again, and I don't know if it's just sort of, you know, the zone read nature of things where, you know, something about Ohio State where they just do not want their outside linebackers out of position, or whether or not this is just the style of these two particular players. But, you know, they take that read step, they take that mirror step, but, you know, this is a pretty straightforward downhill run here.
Yeah. And this is a step that, you know, you look at 43 now back to Lee. And again, his feet aren't in great position. There you said again, that foot up here. He's got one back. And when he does lock out his arms, look how far away he is. He's done. I mean, he's toast in this situation. He's not going to shed and get anybody.
Yeah. So he's going to need to be protected. That's why I say, you know, the more you watch the games that Draft Breakdown has, and, you know, if you watch some of the Bosa games, you can watch, you know, Lee in a lot of these same situations where if he does get isolated on a lineman, he's going to have trouble. So I don't think he's an inside linebacker. I'm not sure. He'd have to be really well protected to be a gap 3-4 will. But the athleticism is there, and, you know, the zone coverage drops are there that I can see why teams comfortably project him into the top 40 picks or so. But I don't know that there's some work to be done here before you got an impact player. I'm not in no way would I say that this is Zach Brown.
Yeah.
In terms of being allergic to contact, in terms of having no interest in doing whatever. And I think there's more athleticism here than what you saw with Zach Brown. But, you know, there's in the same way that you'd want a guy like Brown covered up and give him, you know, a couple of set tasks to do.
What are the things he can do that you think will improve, that can improve right away with his game?
I think he's big enough. I mean, I think he can – I think there should be a reasonable expectation that any linebacker can be taught to attack blocks with a good base and shed at least reasonably. Or if not, you just – as you said, you just tell the guy to go attack the gap in front of you. That's the scheme that you bring him into. Or you have – you know, or he's just going to be a guy that has to play behind a defensive line that's going to cover up these guys and not let a bigger offensive lineman into the second level to get a run at him. So here's where you see, I mean, there's a little bit of a counteraction with that fullback there, and you can see Lee get fooled a little bit by this.
Yeah.
You know, he reads right there, there. Yeah, and then, you know, he's got a free run and he doesn't get there because of that step that he took early on that took him away from the play, which is part of the design of the offensive play. But, you know, if you're going to impact the play at the line of scrimmage, it wasn't the reason for that missed tackle was that step right there.
Yeah.
With his left foot.
And I haven't seen this big piece of a running back here.
Yeah.
Number three.
You know, and here's Lee. I mean, doesn't give up on the play. Some acceleration speed on the backside. Doesn't get down on himself for missing there. He's back here and impacting the play, and he's making a hit. So it's not that he's allergic to whatever. Oh, I made the best chance at doing some ankle biting at the line of scrimmage. There's a lot to like with Lee. But, you know, to put him up in that Miles Jack category is just not going to be the case. And here's another, you know, that's just not.
Nice tackle there.
Yeah. So, I mean, do you consider that a stack and shed? I wouldn't. He makes the play. He's in the play. But, you know, you're getting
no,
basically got mauled back into that play.
Yeah, it was.
He didn't give up there, but that's not.
It's a happy accident.
Yeah.
Yeah, and happy accidents, you know, that's where effort comes in. He fights it. He tries his best, and I like that he's, you know, the way that he fights it, at least he's trying to get the arm over the arm of the man so that he can work outside right here, because he's like, okay, let me get my arm back over here on, and then work through Keller.
So, and that kind of goes back to what we were talking about in the beginning. At least for me, I think he's got the right idea. His eyes are where they're supposed to be, but he doesn't really recognize the blocks coming on him until they're too late, and it just doesn't give him a chance to show whatever functional strength and leverage base that he might have. And again, you see that inside leg, the leg, you know, you need one leg, you need your inside leg between the blocker's legs, and that's where you derive a lot of your functional strength. So he's got the right idea here, but he gets rocked back way too soon. You know, his helmet's good, his pads are good, his hands are arguably good, but he's not ready for the block, and that leg comes up too quick, and he's just
he's
pushed right out of the play.
And then just for fun, I'm, you know, watching number three here breaking Adolphus Washington tackle here in the hole, which, you know, Washington gets, you know, he gets turned a little bit. There's a nice little cut back.
There's enough strength there to run through, yeah.
Yeah, that's kind of nice. All right. So we'll have to keep an eye on Mr. Scott here down the line, at least next year. All right, back to Lee. Let me just see this one more time, because everything he does seems a little hesitant to me in this game.
Yeah, and that was one of the things that was evident in the Notre Dame game is, and when I said, you know, is he playing on athleticism alone? Is he almost gets the sense that his feet are moving a little bit faster than his brain, and then he's doing a little bit of guessing. And again, that always makes me think, not that a player isn't doing a lot in film study, but that he wants to out-athlete what's going on in front of him. So there's a lot of extra steps there. There's a little bit of wasted movement in that. That hurts how well he plays with strength in the game. So instead of taking two or three quick steps there or doing a little bit of stutter, I mean, he's coming up there with a wider base because he's sort of straddling as he comes up. I mean, those steps there are kind of, that just doesn't.
No.
Doesn't look like a player with a plan.
No. And let me ask you this, because Ryan Riddle's talked about this in the past. When we watched Kyle Van Noy a couple years ago, you know, he mentioned he loved how a guy like Van Noy was willing to take some chances every once in a while and maybe not hit the gap he was supposed to and go to a different gap because or take a different angle to a player because he knew that angle was going to work even though it might not have been by the book. So I'm looking at a play like this where there's a blitz and it's, you know, it looks like it's supposed to head into this gap with the guard here. But who's to say, you know, as he's heading up here and he starts to see this play develop and he sees the block develop, say, right here, who's to say that he couldn't, if he sees the pulling guard here, is there something schematically wrong with him saying, I'm going to take my angle further inside and come behind the defender, or is it because he's worried about if he does that, he's leaving a big opening for the quarterback to basically hand the ball off to Scott and let Scott rip through here? I think I lost you. I think you're on mute.
But I'm just not smart enough to know whether this is a designed run blitz, you know, whether or not he sees what could be a zone read and a little bit of a power action coming in his direction, and he's trying to figure out, you know, how he is to maintain his gap, and he gets confused there. or not. But again, to me, it just looks like, you know, just he's not comfortable with what he wants to do when something changes up in front of him there.
Yeah.
And maybe that was, you know, maybe that's a design run blitz there. You see the defensive end come up, you know, he's 59 is coming straight up field here a little bit. So he knows that Lee is coming behind him. So these are things, you know, this is, I always tell folks, you know, this is where if you had played the game, you'd have a little bit better sense of what's going on. And you having watched tape for years and years and years and years, have a little bit better sense of what you're seeing there. Or if I had known, you know, a little bit about how Iowa State likes to play the situation. But I think that's probably part of the hesitance there, is that he sees the blocking scheme changing in front of him and he's not sure exactly where he wants to attack anymore.
Yeah.
But that doesn't mean you still can't be decisive. You don't want to be decisive in the wrong way, but what's going on here is not necessarily productive either.
Yeah. And again, this is also an aspect of just inexperience. He's still a young player, and it's something that maybe as he gets more familiar with the scheme that he plays in, with a team that he's with, if he's able to continue being a starter for 5 or 6 years, by year 7, he might see something like that, sniff that out, and make a big play because of the fact that he's more studied and more experienced in what he's doing. All right, so let's see what we got going on outside here. I mean, he stays in the play on that. It's just, he just doesn't get there.
Yeah, there's not a whole lot of effort to, you know, to get in on the backside of that one there necessarily.
Yeah, either. Yeah, I agree. That's been a little nice.
That wasn't a very good look there.
No, because I mean, look at this. He spins off it, and he has him right here. It's like,
yeah.
That's, I think that's a, I hate to say this, but I think this happens with a lot of players, even though we like to characterize everyone as brave and tough, and they are brave and tough. But it's the fourth quarter. There's 2 minutes left. And I think this number 3's been ripping Ohio State pretty well thus far. And I just don't think 43 wants to go in on the ride right now, even though it's a tie game. But that's a...
Yeah, there may be some fatigue there. This next play is... This doesn't end well for him either.
Okay.
I don't know if you saw this as you let it play through before, but he gets himself in not a very good spot there.
I would have rather ridden number 3 to the ground than having to do that. But
I think that's Conklin again, but...
Yeah. One arm, too. Ugh. So here's the thing that I don't understand. It doesn't even look like the right angle, or again, another hesitant thing. It's like, okay, it looked like he was supposed to come in to the inside shoulder of number 92, and then he decides to bounce it outside right into the Conklin Express. And it's like, do you, you know, it doesn't look like this would be some sort of design play to go inside out like this.
Yeah.
It's either, oops, I forgot I'm supposed to handle this gap, and I'm supposed to do, you know, I'm supposed to handle this gap. Oh, yeah, I got to handle this gap.
I think, and I may be totally off here, but my sense is he is reading the ball. And in almost every play, you can see his helmet on the ball. And then, like I said, he just doesn't, he's not reading the blocking schemes that are in front of him. And he, you know, he has a sense of where he's supposed to be. And then he looks up and he's presented with something different than, you know, the 4 or 5 frames that his brain showed him sooner. And he's catching blocks for that reason. He's relying on athleticism. He's just not,
the decisiveness
isn't there.
Yeah, he's not understanding, like you said, he doesn't understand the scheme, or he's not looking at the scheme as his fit. So if he guesses right, then he ends up in situations like this. But he guesses wrong, and it's like the play before where he's steamrolled.
And I think that's why we're seeing some folks on Twitter maybe mistake allergic to contact for, you know, his indecisiveness, so to speak, when he's not free to roam. and come downhill, as he doesn't really want to put his head in there.
And this may also explain why he, I mean, I haven't studied enough of his tape, but it would be worth, after knowing this, I would look at his other tape and start looking at, you know, if you don't mind, we can look at the Hawaii tape for a little bit here. Is one that you mentioned for pass drops, but for coverage drops, but it's like, I would look at other tape and wonder if Lee is a player who, you know, because he's not decisive, he's not getting himself in good situations to make tackles with good angles, and that's what's causing him to miss tackles. You know, so.
I think that's probably accurate. There were a number of times in the Notre Dame game, there were a number of tackles that he made where, you know, you could see him when he did feel comfortable with whatever he decided to do. There's a lot of good acceleration there and some finishing speed.
Yeah. So you mentioned this game before online that maybe there were a couple of plays to take a look at in terms of his pass coverage. And it looks like this could be one of them here. Should we take a couple minutes to look at this?
Yeah, I think the first couple of minutes of the Hawaii game, there's a number of these situations where, and in the Notre Dame game, where he's, you know, he's outside the hash marks and they're asking him to do some of these things. So this is a good situation where athleticism doesn't necessarily translate to that first play there.
Yeah.
Where he's a little flat footed. His eyes are in the backfield. He doesn't react quickly. You know, you like his stance. You know, his first move isn't terrible. He's in a back pedal. He already opens his hips, but he's not there.
Yeah. He's not anticipating this well enough. And maybe he's playing it safe, but it's too safe. Especially when you have a safety that deep. Okay, so once again in the left-hand corner here.
There's a lot of what looks like man coverage in the Ohio State scheme to where, you know, they're playing, it's not a true man under zone deep type read, but they do a lot of mirroring in the first 5 yards, maybe a little bit of a soft jam, and then pass off to zone coverage. And that's a little bit of what you had there on that last play. So here's another situation where he's running around blocks.
Yep.
And failing to come downhill decisively.
And here he is. I mean, right here, he's got a straight shot.
Yeah.
If he's a step earlier with his decision, he has this as a tackle for a short gain.
Well, after he evades that block, it's pretty evident what he needs to do. But he's just not, he wasn't as aggressive downhill as you'd have liked him to be.
No. All right, so now we look like we've got a bit of possible of a pass situation here. Nope, they go run. All right. Now we're cooking, I think. Let's see. Nope. I'm not playing good defense tonight.
No, you're all right. The zone read is, I have to say, it's an annoying thing to try to get a sense of how college guys are going to react to blocks and misdirection. So there's a situation where you'll see him take a couple of extra steps on play action that can get him into trouble.
Yeah.
His responsibility is to kind of drop out in that curl area. And he recognizes it quickly enough.
So what's the difference between what he did here and what would be better for him to do so in the NFL? What would happen in the NFL with what he did right here?
Yeah, I just, you know, I like to see these guys just, you know, that's a little bit more than a read step. That's him, again, reading the ball first.
Yeah, jumping.
Yeah, and I just, you know, I always like to see that because it's hard to recover from this position that he's in here now. You know, the wider your base is, the harder it is to, you know, he's kind of rocked back. He's stumbling back there a little bit. He's quick and athletic enough to recover. But that's, you know, it's just lost time here again and wasted energy.
Doesn't he? And now, if he didn't step there, would he have been in a better position to at least get the hash a little bit further out
Roll that back one more time. Okay. Sometimes, and the other thing that's just freeze it for a second. The difficult thing about this for me is I'm watching feet and all that other sort of stuff. What might be going on here, this might be a zone blitz look. So this may have been what was intended all along for him to drop back out into this little hot route situation. So it's probably more important to watch what's going on at the top of the line here than what's going on with Lee. Yeah, that's a little bit what's going on here. This is probably just a designed fire zone here on 3rd and 7, more than a false step for him, because that was such a violent first step and then rock back. I bet that's what this was supposed to be. This is part of his own blitz, and that was an intentional deal. Now, you'd probably still like him to see a little bit of balance here, but that's probably more as you look at this with a little bit, you know, more overall view here. I think that's more likely what's going on, that's a designed fire zone more than anything else.
And that's an important point. I mean, as someone like myself who watches much more offense and defense, and I do these shows because it gives me a chance to learn more about defense, one of the things that, Gene, you just brought up that reminds me of what I do on an offensive standpoint is I try to watch the play as a whole and what's going on in the scope of the play before I actually watch the player and study what they do. And as someone who's looking at this less experienced from a defensive side of the ball, I forget that. And it's easy to like start just paying attention to the player and reacting to that and then missing the context.
And we're rolling this tape through, but I know, and I do the same thing, is depending on what I've decided I want to focus on with any given player, you'll sort of, I mean, you've got this going half speed, but you'll stop, start. I like to see who's moving quickly. I want to watch what the offensive line is doing, because, and then you get a sense of, is this player reading the guard? Is he reading the ball through the back? What are they trying to key on? So I like to see who's moving first, and then the offensive line will generally tell you what's going to go on with the play. And then you can kind of look at the front seven, and then you can pay a little bit more attention to technique. When we just have a player here that we're watching, sometimes it's, like you said, you know, it's a little bit easier to get caught up on, you know, just watching the details of the technique without trying to put together what the thought process was. And you know, I freely admit that's something that I struggle with, because, you know, I have a lot of experience with playbooks and knowing how teams are choosing to defend certain things right now and what these guys are asked to do. And even if you do know, sometimes you don't know exactly what's going on in their head. And I think, you know, that's one of the reasons you do such a good job, you know, just going back to some of the Vad Lee stuff that you've been doing lately, to be able to put that together without having any of that knowledge is part of the battle. And that's how easy you can get fooled right there, is I'm thinking, well, you know, this is another situation akin to what I've seen in other plays with him, where, you know, it's clearly he's been fooled by play action, but that's not really what was going on in that other play.
Yeah, absolutely. And so, I mean, it's, you know, that's what makes evaluation such a difficult craft, because of the fact that it's, you have to be so methodical about it all the time. And even then, there's a level of guesswork and a canyon that you have to cross at times. I mean, it's like quarterback play. I've been thinking about that. I'm writing an article on Christian Hackenberg and revisiting him a little bit after watching the John Gruden film room. And it was one of those deals where watching Gruden go about this, I thought to myself, maybe I can see how Gruden thinks of him as a first round pick, even though I have him rated as my 18th quarterback out of, you know, very low. But I can see why he says some of the things he did, because he's like, look, you know, his footwork got changed midway through his career and he wasn't comfortable with it. And the footwork that he was doing as a freshman was more traditional, good quality fundamental footwork. So if you're not even using the type of footwork that you're comfortable with, you know, during the year, that can make you overthink things. It can make you feel uncomfortable. You're distracted a little bit. If you're different, have differences with blocking scheme, that can change things. And then I start to think to myself, well, okay, well, maybe I can see where he can be a better player. But at the same time, then there's things I see that where I think he's overthinking things so much, or he's overreacting to things so much that I'm thinking, okay, it doesn't matter what's going on with the technique. If he's not able to look at these things, it's not going to, you know, he's not going to be able to make the adjustment. But there may be even middle ground where it's like, if he's removed from the distractions of the fundamental issues that he's been facing with that have conflicted with his normal technique, maybe he'll be a little bit sharper with the decisions that he makes looking at the field. And these are, you know, that's what makes evaluation difficult, because of all these different factors that you have to kind of guess and project. You may know about scheme, you may know about protections, you may know what the player is trying to do and not trying to do and what he's thinking, but then you still have to deal with the fact of, what does he do after he gets dominated? What is he, how does he react after physical play? How does he react when the when they're down by a lot? Does he give up? You know, how does he react to the grind of the game, where it's like, you know, it's easy to say, oh, when I get paid, you know, $6 million and I have, you know, I have a guaranteed amount of money to begin with, and now I actually have a comfortable living, are you going to be motivated to work every day like you did when you were trying to get into the league? You know, people say that that's, well, it should be easier, but you could be complacent in those situations too, because now you have the, you know, the life's easier for you and no one's looking at you now because you're a backup and you've made it, you've made money, and you think, well, you know, I'll get away with what I'm doing right now because I'm on the team, you know, and I think a lot of guys fall into that trap and don't realize that you've got to be, you got to be working really hard even when no one's watching you, or else you're going to get exposed when it's time for them to put their eyes on you, and suddenly they're going, you're not as good as we thought you were. We're going to find somebody else now, and now you're looking for another team.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that's the case, and I, you know, I think that's, you know, you focus on the technical side of things, but there's so much you don't know, and I think it's one of the reasons you got to like Gruden sitting down with those guys and putting them through the paces and challenging them on their thinking. That only helps everybody get better with evaluations and seeing how the league puts those players through the paces. It'd be nice to see some of that on the defensive side of the ball too. I think, you know, I think there's a lot to like with Lee there. I don't know that he's as scheme versatile as some of these other players. There's definitely, there's going to be teams that have questions about how strongly he finishes, what his processing speed is like. You know, does his processing speed match his physical speed? But I think there's good reason to consider him at the top part of the off-ball linebacker group this year. And I'm, you know, what you hope is that he grows into the position pretty quickly in the first couple of years. I don't think he's going to come into the league and be, you know, a Luke Kuechly or, you know, that sort of instinctive type player. And I don't think he's got, you know, he's showing you the same things that guys like Lavonte David or Bobby Wagner or other guys over the years have. But I think there's reason to think that he can grow into a pretty solid player, and his athleticism certainly puts him in the conversation to play on every down. Hopefully that's the way it works out for him.
Well, there you go, folks. That's what we got to see tonight with Jene Bramel, and when we get to watch Darron Lee. And, you know, I would say that hopefully if you're watching this after the draft as well, because I know there are going to be plenty of people who are going to be tuning in after the draft to see some of these players, that you'll get an idea of what to expect from Lee year one. And for on behalf of Jene Bramel, we want to thank you guys for watching us at the RSP Film Room. You can check out more of our episodes at the RSP Film Room on the YouTube channel or at www.mattwaldmanrsp.com. You can follow Jene Bramel at Jene Bramel and see all the great work that he does at Football Guys, and occasionally gets to do, you know, for me during the Senior Bowl at the RSP blog, and then also the fantastic job he does to help edit the RSP publication, which I won't go into detail here since we're doing this as a film room, but just to say that, you know, definitely appreciated the work that he does both, you know, in the public eye and behind the scenes. So thanks, everyone. You guys have a good night.